Christ alone, what is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong, who holds our days within His hand. What comes apart from His command, and what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. Troubled soul, God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our great Redeemer's blood, who holds our faith when fears arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ. Oh, sing hallelujah, our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing hallelujah, now and ever we confess Christ our hope in life and death. Christ He lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with Him, there we will rise to meet the Lord. Then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will feast in endless joy when Christ is ours forevermore.
Like to welcome you to our Scrabble online service, and we trust today that as we hear God's word, that God might speak to our hearts, and as we listen to the praise, we can sing along, or we can reflect just on the person of the Lord Jesus. Now, as we are watching this, as you're watching this service today, there is a service which is happening in Scrabble Hall. It's the first time I've been able to meet since the pandemic. And at 10:45 this morning, there's a breaking of bread service, and that goes on until 20 past 11. And then from 11:30 to 12:15, there's a family service, which is very much like the service which we've all been watching over the last weeks and months. Now, we are installing a new camera in the hall, and that will enable us in the next 2 or 3 weeks to have live streaming. And whenever that happens, we will be able to do away with this pre-recorded service and be able to watch the on live stream as what is happening in the hall. Now, whenever we are meeting in the hall, protocols have been put in place to keep us all safe. And the deacons have been working very hard to enable this to happen. One of the protocols is social distancing, and that will allow just over 70 people in the main auditorium. So it is important that we know who is coming so we have enough seating available, and details of which will follow on the next slide. For the rest of the week, we have our prayer meeting on Wednesday, and that will be by Zoom as well as meeting in the hall. And again, if you plan to come down to the hall, please register with David Gallagher. Now, for our meeting today, there will be a praise item, and then there'll be a reading by Caroline Martin. And then we have a message by John Speirs. Now, John is a regular visitor to Scrabble. He comes from Scotland. We're very glad that he's taken the time to do this, and we look forward to what he has to say to us from God's Word. After that, there'll be another praise item. And today, there'll be no remembrance of the Lord breaking of bread at this pre-recorded message, but it will be because of what we are having in the hall. And tonight then, from 6 o'clock, John Speirs will bring us God's Word again, teaching us from Psalm 91. So we're just going to commit our time to God in prayer. Loving Heavenly Father, I thank you that we're able to come here this morning. And we thank you that we have the freedom in this country to worship you. You're a great God who is worthy of all our worship and praise. We thank you for the gift of your Son, the Lord Jesus. We thank you that he came to this earth, that he walked among us. And we thank you that he willingly went to the cross and died. And I thank you, Father, that through that we have been reconciled to you. We've been brought back into relationship to you for those who have trusted in you. And we pray, Lord, just this morning that as John opens your word, your holy, precious word, that it might speak to every heart. It might speak to my heart. It might speak to the heart of everyone who hears. Lord, I pray that as we listen to the praise, that, Lord, we might, our hearts might overflow with thankfulness to you for what you have done for us through Christ. And for, Lord, just everywhere else in this country where similar gatherings are meeting, Lord, and your word goes forth, we pray, Lord, that you'll bless your word abundantly, that you'll draw people to yourself. And we thank you once again, Lord, for this opportunity to come together in and through the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
You chose the cross with every breath, the perfect life, the perfect death. And the Chorus says, I'm lost in wonder, lost in love, lost in praise forevermore. Let's join together in You Chose the Cross.
Chose the cross with every breath, the perfect life, the perfect death. You chose the cross, a crown of thorns you wore for us, crowned us with eternal.
Lost in love, lost in love.
cross of Jesus, unfailing love. I am forgiven, I am restored.
The reading for this morning is taken from John chapter 11, verses 38 to 57. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odour, for he has been there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did, put their faith in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. "What are we accomplishing?" they asked. "Here is this man performing many miraculous signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. And then the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." Then one of them named Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, spoke up. "You know nothing at all. You do not realize that it is better for one man to die for the people than that the whole nation perish." He did not say this on his own, but as high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation, and not only for that nation, but also for the scattered children of God, to bring them together and make them one. So from that day on, they plotted to take his life. Therefore, Jesus no longer moved about publicly among the Jews. Instead, he withdrew to a region near the desert, to a village called Ephraim, where he stayed with his disciples. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, many went up from the country to Jerusalem for their ceremonial cleansing before the Passover. They kept looking for Jesus, and as they stood in the temple area, they asked one another, "What do you think? Isn't he coming to the feast at all?" But the chief priests and Pharisees had given orders that if anyone found out where Jesus was, he should report it, so that they might arrest him.
Good morning to all the friends in Scrabble. I would have loved to have been with you in person, but conditions prevailing these days doesn't allow that, and so it's through video I am sending this message to you. The focus this morning in the message is the death of Lazarus from John chapter 11. In these days of pandemic, we have been confronted more than ever with the reality of death. When we think of over 41,000 here in the UK, we think of 1,200 every day in Brazil, we think of 800,000 globally have died as a result of COVID-19. And beyond the statistics, we have to realize that everybody is somebody. Every one of us usually are rocked in our emotions when a family member dies, especially if it's unexpected. Some years ago, I was here in Ulster conducting a gospel mission down in Armagh in Woodford Hall, night by night preaching. One night after preaching and standing in the car park, I received a phone call from my brother to tell me our father had died. And the memory of his death and the subsequent events to it, I will never forget. I went home to Scotland, to my own little village, for the funeral. And one of the most moving and humbling experiences of my life was to go into the little gospel hall and discover that five brothers from the church in Woodford Hall had travelled by car and by ferry to come to my father's funeral to give me support. I'll never forget their devotion. When we left the hall to go to the cemetery, the undertaker was leading us to an open grave. I whispered to him, "You're taking us to the wrong grave." "Oh no, sir, we can never make that mistake." But they did. So he had to continue with the burial and buried my father in the wrong grave. So that the next day I had to attend a sheriff court to seek permission to have his body and coffin exhumed. And I went back to the cemetery and stood alone and watched my father being buried again. He was buried twice. Interesting enough, in the flyleaf of his Bible, I remember reading two phrases that he had written. "Born to die, 14 February 1907. Underneath, "Born to live," and the date of his conversion. So my father was born twice, born again second time, and buried twice. Quite unusual. And when we come to the story of Lazarus, we recognize again, here was a man who was buried twice. Most unusual. It is one of the greatest miracles in the life of Jesus. And while we're going to say something this morning in the context of Lazarus' death, I want also to focus on life. And I want to consider with you three simple ideas. I want to talk about family life. I want to say something about the fragility of life. And I want to say something in answer to the question put to me by our friends here in Scrabble. What next after Lazarus was raised from the dead? And so I want to say something about our future life, our family life, the fragility of life, and our future life. Under the title of family life, let us understand that in the culture of the Jewish people, they've always had a high priority for family life. God was the designer of family life. The stability of any nation is determined by the strength of its family life. The breakdown in family relationships, of course, leads to the disintegration of society. This little family at the heart of John 11, a family of three, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. I've often pondered why in Scripture there is no mention of the parents. Had they died? And did that bring the three family members closer together? The Bible says that Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And when he arrived at the graveside, Jesus wept. He did not hesitate to express his feelings, because tears are an integral part of family life. The message that was sent to Jesus was, "The one you love is sick." And when the bystanders saw him weep, they recognized his love for the family. That family was loved by Jesus. That's why when death invades a family, there is great grief and pain. I was thinking about the families who lost loved ones at the Manchester bombing in recent days, still going through the pain and grief of death. And my question this morning to each one of us is to ask, are you in the family of God? It is essential to be born again into the family of God. For myself, I have been born twice. Born on the 23rd of September, 1943. Born again on the 2nd of January, 1956. In John chapter 1 and verse 10, when Jesus came, he was rejected. But as many as received him, to them gave he the right to be called the children of God. The family of God is the greatest family in the whole world. I have brothers and sisters scattered all over Africa and India, and I love them because we belong to the same family. Secondly, let me deal with the fragility of life. During these days of pandemic, I had two very close friends who contracted COVID-19, both husband and wife, taken into hospital. We feared greatly for the life of dear Edith, who was a severe asthmatic. But as it turned out, on Easter Sunday morning, Edith was taken in a wheelchair to the ward where her husband Donald lay, and she watched him go to heaven. The fragility of life was such that Donald was taken and Edith survived. Dr. Luke tells us in his gospel there was an occasion of a little girl of 12 who died. A widow's son died. Death is no respecter of age or status. Some may ask, why did Jesus delay going to Bethany and visit Lazarus and heal and restore him from whatever illness he had? He waited 2 days, and then it took 2 days for them to go. The fact, of course, was that Lazarus was dead by the time Jesus got the message. And when Jesus arrives to comfort the two sisters, and when he sees the emotional turmoil that they have, he weeps, not only for them, but with them. Beyond his tears, Jesus must have understood and thought about the consequences of sin, declared by God in the Garden of Eden. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. Death is the result of sin. How fragile is humanity? The words of Job, chapter 14, says, how frail is humanity? How short is life? Like a flower, we blossom for a moment, then wither. Like a shadow of a passing cloud, we quickly disappear. I don't think for a moment that the two sisters thought that Lazarus would die. And we are reminded of how sudden and unexpected death can come. So let us think not only of family life and the fragility of life, but our future life. It was a shock for the mourners at the graveside when Jesus called for the stone to be removed from the mouth of the grave. Martha protested against this action, but Jesus reminded her that she would see God's glory if she believed that Jesus was the resurrection and the life. Jesus offers a short prayer, a lesson for all of us who pray. Then he calls Lazarus to step forth from the grave, and alive and still dressed in his shroud, Lazarus responds to Christ's call. I'm sure that the joy of these two sisters in witnessing their brother alive would have been wonderful. This miracle, as all the miracles in John's Gospel, is a sign that after death there will be resurrection. So in answer to the question put to me by Trevor, what next? I assure you, says Jesus in John chapter 5, verse 24, that those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. They will never be condemned for their sin, but they have already passed from death unto life. In verse 28 of John 5, don't be so surprised. Indeed, the time is coming when all the dead in their graves will hear the voice of God's Son. We all have a future life, either in heaven or in hell. And these destinations are realities, and we need to face up to them. For many years, and I don't want to trivialize this idea, but for many years, I used to preach every 12th fortnight in Newcastle on the promenade in the open air. Open air preaching was a great thrill and joy for me. And you were often heckled by a passerby. Sometimes when a man got too much drink, he was freer to heckle you. In one open air, there was a man preaching, and the heckler shouted to him to interrupt him, "Where did Cain get his wife?" But the preacher continued. But the heckler continued. So eventually, to silence the heckler, he said, "When I get to heaven, I'll ask him." And the heckler replied quickly, "But what if he's not in heaven?" The preacher replied, "Then you ask him." Reminding us very forcibly that there's two destinations, heaven or hell. You don't receive eternal life when you die. You receive eternal life now when you believe that Christ died on the cross for your sin, and you believe that God raised Christ from the grave. What a wonderful hope every believer has for the future. Lazarus was used by Jesus as a sign that after death, we have a future. Make sure that when the trumpet sounds, you will take part in the glorious future that God has planned for every believer. And so, as we reflect on this amazing miracle of Lazarus being raised from being a corpse to life again and having a future with his two sisters, may God help us to recognize that we need to be in the family of God, and we need to be ready because of the fragility of life. We need to be ready for our future in heaven. Can I take this opportunity at the end of this message just to say thank you to everyone who has supported me over these days with the project of the booklet Keep Me Safe Till the Storm Passes By. We've been able to move 2,500 copies, and we have reprinted. And therefore, if you would like a copy, or you've never had a copy of the booklet, then feel free to contact my friend Philip Johnson, and he has supplies available. May God bless you through this message this morning.
When my hope and strength is gone, you're the one who calls me on. You're the life, you're the fight to send my soul. Let's join together and sing, "We Are More Than Conquerors."
When my hope and strength is gone, you're the one who calls me on. You are the life, you are the fight that's in my soul. Oh, your resurrection power burns like fire in my heart. When waters rise, I
Thankful to John for his message and trust that you've been blessed by it through God's holy word. Now just to remind you once again that services will be taking place going forward in Scrabble, and there is a need to register, please. I'm just going to pray now and just commit us to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that it is living, that it is real. We thank you that we have it, Lord, and we can look into the pages of Holy Scripture and you can speak to each of our hearts. And as we, Lord, step out this week, Lord, may we know that we are loved by God. May we know that we have Jesus with us in every situation. I pray, Lord, you'd help us to be salt and light to those we come in contact with. We pray, Lord, that people might see Jesus through us. And Lord, we look forward to meeting together again and in Scrabble, and Lord, meeting, being with each other. And I pray, Lord, that you will guide and direct us as we, Lord, will do this. So we ask and pray this in and through the precious name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.